Okay guys, so this is how, for the BTC70 Tesla coil, this is how you will be receiving it when you open it up out of your crate. This is what the individual parts will be. So we'll go from here on the setup and show you how to put it together. The first thing here, this is the strike ring. This is how it'll be on top of the primary coil in the base there. There'll be a piece of insulation between the two of padding. But this is the orientation that'll be, and the reason we do this is because it's a very specific way to set this up onto the base. All right, so.
So this will lift up.
Yep.
And you'll be removing these. There'll be a nut, I mean, there'll be a washer, a nut, and an acorn nut on each one of these. You'll have to remove all of these from the top of the base, mm-hmm. like we have all the way around.
Each of the four corners will have one. Just remove those first, yep.
Right. Set this strike ring down onto the studs. Now the spacer will be in the front here by the capacitor. Mm-hmm. We got to make sure that this ground connection is on the same side pointing down as the green wire for the ground connection for the cable. Okay, once you have the orientation right, we're going to put on a washer and a nut on each one, and then tighten it down fairly firmly. It has to hold the weight of the coil, so it should be pretty snug.
It should be pretty snug, yeah. You don't want to over-tighten it. You can crack the Lexan, but it should be on there. What would you think? Once you start getting resistance, we want to turn it another... Well, we'll see when we do it.
Yeah. You don't have to reef down on it, but tight. Tight enough where it doesn't wobble. And holds it fairly firmly.
Okay, so once you get it snug, I'm just curious to see how many turns.
It's about one turn once it's snug, you know what I mean? Firm.
Yeah, it should be on there firm.
Okay, once we have that on there, we're going to put these acorn nuts on here for aesthetics. And they just have to be on there tight enough so they don't fall off.
Right.
Okay, so when you get it out of the crate, the tap won't be attached. And it'll be tucked underneath. There'll be a section that's marked off where the tap goes. And this is for tuning, but we pre-tune it, so you should not have to move this tap. Right there. Okay, once you get the strike ring on, you want to center it up evenly with the primary. It can slide in these little brackets. It doesn't have to be really tight. And, you know, it's about... 4 inches away on either side. Okay, let's get this a little wide. Bring that in. And, you have to make adjustments to make it nice and round. It's copper, it bends easy. Alright, that looks fairly nice. Beautifully spaced. Okay. We are going to...
Now the next part is the...
Put the secondary...
Okay.
On top of the base.
Want me to help with that?
Yep.
Yeah. All right.
There's a top and bottom. The top has high voltage warning stickers on it. That goes to the top. That's the bottom. We'll have the nuts on the studs here, top and bottom. We take these nuts off and loose them. We can put this up here. Just help me here grab the middle of it. Nice job. Okay, once you have the secondary, you can put the high voltage sticker in the front. Okay, you're going to have a little piece of green ground wire with a lug on it. And you'll take your brass nut, and on the ground side where the tab is for the ground, you're going to want to put this lug on the stud of the coil.
You turn that up, yeah.
It should be fairly firm too, because it has to hold the secondary. Okay. Now we're going to connect our, we're going to use our designated ground.
Oh, the ground line here? Okay.
If you want to...
Yeah, so we have a ground line here, and this runs, you can't see it, there's a little bit of a working mess here. It runs to the circuit box for electricity, which is grounded to the outside. I'll show you that your ground that goes to the Tesla coil, like this wire here, has to be grounded to the outside. All right, and this is the outside ground here. We actually have two grounds. One is staked in here into the earth. That's a rod pounded about 2 feet into the ground. And then there's another one pounded in right here. Where are we? Yeah, there we are. So there are two rods in the ground. You don't necessarily need two, but we have two. But you definitely need one, and it has to be pounded into the earth for a dedicated ground line. So here we have the ground line coming out.
Okay, so we have the ground line from the bottom of the secondary.
All right, this is the other.
We have the ground line from this terminal block, which goes to the fans, and we have our designated ground.
From the outside.
From the outside.
Earth ground.
All together into this lug right here. First, make sure they're in there all the way. And we're going to tighten this down tight.
Yeah.
Don't have to be so tight you'd chop the wire off or anything, but, you know, it's a good connection. Okay, we have the ground set up now. Okay. Now, we can put our insulator and our spacer and the toroid on the secondary.
All right.
So, black spacer. And slide over this coil. Usually put the screws in the back so it looks pretty.
Ah, yes.
And just center it up. It's evenly on each side. It's
about half an inch or so.
Right. Okay. And you'll have a spacer that goes on top of the coil. That can float around. You want to center that up too.
Yeah, it just floats on there. Yeah.
Right. It just kind of floats up there. Chair. Yeah, I can lift that up there if you want. And if you want to guide it. Okay, I can't.
That
goes on there. Okay, you can center this up right here. And the coil will be centered obviously by itself. 1/4-20 brass nut. Always use brass.
Always use brass, absolutely.
We'll tighten this up with a wrench. Okay.
I don't know if you can see that, but yeah, you should be able to.
Right. Okay. The chassis of the coil is assembled.
The chassis is complete.
All right.
Should I stop it here?
For connection's sake,
Okay. We can
turn this around.
Okay.
Okay, now, this cover will be screwed on here. We leave it off for testing purposes. Leave that there.
And the main reason you want to keep that on is for the ultraviolet light, kind of a shielding from the ultraviolet light, yeah.
because it's very bright here. This is a high voltage area. You don't want to be near this or touching any of this. Okay. So, you have two sets of high voltage cables which go to this coil. 30 feet long. Right. Both ends are the same. It's irrelevant. One goes where? Screwdriver. All right. We're going to want to stretch these out.
Mm-hmm.
So each wire is going to go on either end of this spark gap through this terminal right here. And I'm just going to tighten this up fairly tightly.
And do the same on the other side.
Likewise with this. Okay. And this cover will be attached on here, like so.
So move the power supply. From the coil, huh?
Yeah, this is, you're gonna wanna be at least this far. This is about what? 11 feet.
Maybe 12, yeah. I'm not getting super detailed, but yeah.
Okay. This is our transformer section here. We designed this so you can have a control panel either sitting on the transformer, or you can lift this off.
Well, you can get it a further distance if you want to.
You could set it on a table and have the transformer somewhere between the control and the coil.
And the Tesla coil, yeah.
Well, for now, we're going to leave it on top of the transformer box. And this will have a 220, 60 hertz, single phase outlet. All right, we'll have to move this closer, but for now, we'll show the connections.
Yeah.
Just sit there. Okay, the high voltage wires. You want to keep these, they can be bundled up a little bit, but you don't want to cross them.
Yeah.
Okay, now on the transformer, there's a black safety cover here. You'll remove the screws. For now, we have it off to show the connections.
Mm-hmm.
And let me get my screwdriver.
Sure.
Okay, now we're going to connect the high voltage cable to the output of the transformer box. And these pretty tight. String the other one. Your high voltage connection.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a black cover that goes on here. There's a couple screw holes to protect you from the high voltage here and here.
Okay.
Okay, now we've got to connect the power for the fan and the ground for the unit. And you want to keep this away from the high voltage also.
Yeah, so
you want to
separate the wires basically.
Separate the wires. You don't have to stretch them out straight. You want to leave yourself a little so you can. Okay, this is the connections on the terminal block here. Okay. It's going to be, they'll be labeled here what the colors are.
But and this is for the fan.
This is for the fan.
On
and
the spark gap.
And there's a ground back to the control box.
Mm.
So we go black. I have to get a different screwdriver. White. And green. Green goes to the ground.
All right, so just tighten that down, each of those.
Okay.
So this is pretty much all set up. All right, so you got the ground line in the back here, and you got the fan power line here, and then the two high voltage lines going to the spark gap and then to the high voltage output of the power supply. All the lines, you just want to keep them away from each other. You don't want them across each other. It's the main thing.
Oh, so there'll be a key. It'll be attached to the transformer, probably on this little handle here. And there's a remote switch also. All right. A remote switch. It just allows you to stand elsewhere, operate the coil. There's also another switch on the control box which can operate the coil. The remote switch plugs into the 1/8-inch jack.
Yep, I think that's pretty
much all the connections except for plugging it into the outlet.
Okay.
This goes right to here. Okay.
So on that output goes into the circuit breaker, and what did you say? It was a dual 50 amp?
250 amp breakers.
250 amp breakers. To power this. I'm not sure which of those two it is.
The one that says front welder.
Front welder, okay. So it's a dual 50 amp breaker.
Need 10,000 watts at 220 volts.
First thing when you get this, you'll want to take off the safety wire from the capacitor that's on there for shipping, just to make sure that no static charge builds up. But you have to remove that or it won't hold a charge.
It would explode pretty good too. Okay, so we remove this safety wire here.
And it's just a thin wire that's on both sides.
All right.
The capacitor.
Remove this. Take this off of here. Unwind this from here.
Now what are you doing over there?
Okay. And here's the wire. You can discard this or save it.
Save it if you want to pack this up for a long period of time or something like that, and you can put that on.
Capacitors sometimes tend to charge themselves just hanging around in staticky air.
Yeah, if you don't have this plugged in and grounded, it might build up a charge.
Right.
So just for long-term storage, you don't have to put the safety wire on it after every time you use it.
Okay, I'm going to take a look at the tap. Now the tap wire, you want to keep as round as possible and just about where this sits right now. You don't want this crossing or touching the primary. You don't want this tap wire too awful close to this metal here. There's a lot of voltage going through here, so it's pretty far away right here. No loop, no coils in it. It can loop, but no coils.
You're right.
Okay, and the other thing about the tap can only be on one section of the primary. If it's leaning over and touching another one, you'll have a big burn and a lot of problems. So this tap has the plastic right here, which insulates it from the next one. They never arc over, but if it does fall, you have a chance that it won't touch that one. But you keep this straight up and down, and you can keep this away from this nut here by putting a little bend in this right here. The wire, you probably have to mess with this wire a little tiny bit. All right, so this is nice and neat, follows the primary coil.
All right, just kind of an equal distance as much as you can from anything that's metal.
Right. Okay, and our next safety is to make sure your grounds are all connected.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Now, after you operate the coil, we're going to furnish you with a grounding rod, much like this one, but nicer. This grounding rod can connect to this ground here, anywhere on this ring or on this ground. So, after the coil is been used, sometimes you'll have a static charge in the coil, and a static charge you can get from here. Nothing that will hurt you, but, after you shut the unit off, it's always safe to ground the toroid, and then you can take this wand. You don't have to touch the metal to the outside of the, but if you run the plastic, it will disperse most of the static charge.
If anything is in there.
If there's anything there.
Yeah.
You still might, if you rub your hand on it, sometimes you'll get a little static shock. It's like rubbing your feet on the carpet.
Oh, okay. So it's just unpleasant.
And as long as the unit is off and unplugged, you can discharge the secondary, make sure there's no charge here, but make sure there's no power going to it. Okay.
And this is after everything's shut off, right, of course.
And then...
And this is something you would want to do if you want to do some work on the Tesla coil, adjust the spark gaps or something like that.
And for safety, you could connect this here to here, one side without being anywhere near anything else, and make sure the capacitor is discharged by... You could either bridge this with a screwdriver or use a grounding rod. If you don't want to connect the thing to the... You can take a screwdriver and just make sure the safety gap here is short to safety gap, and if there's any charge, it'll discharge right there.
Oh, okay, with the screwdriver.
Get a small pop.
Yeah.
Now, the safety gap right here, it's part of the operation, but we're here anyways, is set for over voltage. If you're using the unit and you hear this loud pop, pop, it's a safety gap. It's nothing major, but if you hear some pops, this one is set just on the fringe of the voltage that's going to it. If you do get a pop once in a while, you can back this off at about a quarter turn of time until the popping just stops. You don't want to back it off too far. This gap is important in case there's any breakdown. It'll jump that and not destroy everything else. Okay. It doesn't have to be super far away, but, you know.
You shouldn't be, crossing any paths.
6 or 8 inches.
Okay.
Is fine. And once you have these stretched out, you know, they could be coiled like this, but not coiled on top of each other. Other safety factors. Avoid looking at the light from the spark gaps or touching anything in the spark gaps unless it's discharged.
Right.
We have our spark gaps pre-adjusted. You can retune this coil up and down if you like there, but it's all set. You can open up the gaps, but then you have to retune the tap where the tap on the secondary is. And you really have to know a lot about these to tune coils, but can be done.
Okay, anything else with safety issues? Basically,
okay,
just...
Okay, now before plugging it in, right, we want to make sure that the, key is out. The variac is turned fully counterclockwise to zero. This way. Zoop, that is off. Okay. We make sure that the circuit breaker is off. Okay, now we can get into operation. Okay, you'll have your... You all set?
Yes.
You'll have your remote, which I, you can lay right here, which I usually do. Okay, we're going to plug the unit into our 220 single phase outlet. Okay. Next thing, we will take our key, put it in to there. Key is off. Okay, and we will turn on the main power with a fuse. The fans will start turning because the fans run independently of the power to the coil. They cool down and quench the spark gaps. Neon light indicates that you have 220 volts. For operation, we turn the lockout key on. When the green light's on, that means that it's armed. Okay, if you press either one of the fire buttons, you'll hear the relay inside switching the 220 on and off.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And this button will operate the same as the remote. Okay, we're ready to fire the coil right now. To be safe, I usually will turn this variac up to 100.
100 on the, okay.
And we're gonna press the fire button. It won't have much output, but if there's any kind of problem, you'll know it right off the bat. Okay, I'm actually at 150.
You're at 150?
Yeah. We don't want to run it full power just yet until you make sure that there's no problems, it's working. Okay, and we're gonna test fire this at 150. We should have some output. It will be small. Everything seems to be functioning very well. Now we're gonna turn the variac all the way up.
Okay.
We can max this variac to 250, and the coil should operate. Now, time for operation, less than a minute.
At a time you run at a minute?
Yeah, less than a minute. Minute is a long time.
It is a long time.
Yep. You know, good 20, 45 seconds.
I'm going to stand over here, so don't fire it yet. So basically, that's all there is to the operation. Just adjust the variac to the setting that you want.
Right. Now, and it'll operate, you know, between 150 and, we'll set this at 175.
For the red, okay.
Right. It operates the best.
At full power.
At full power.
Okay.
And we'll put it back to full power.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We're going to shut the variac all the way off.
Okay.
Turn the key off and shut the breaker off. And now we're going to show, you can use a breakout pin.
I think that was over there, yeah.
Now, breakout pin is just a small piece of bus wire. I use a little piece of tape. It will have, the output of the coil will come off the tip of the pin. In any kind of direction you like. We can put this on here.
And you notice this is right after we just ran it. You really don't even need to charge.
Yeah, I touched it. It's, you know, and it might be a little static here. If you go like this, you can feel a little.
You can feel a little bit of it?
Yep.
Yeah. But as you can see, we just ran it. Didn't have to touch it with the grounding rod, and it's perfectly safe to touch as long as it's not. There's no power going to it.
Strike rod that we use for testing, and the breakout pin and the ground rod should be very directional. And it's fun because the output is very intense. So we're going to turn the unit on again. Make sure the variac is off. Turn on the key. Turn the variac up all the way. And the arc should go to the grounding rod. It's an interesting effect.
Absolutely. Very directed, very powerful. All right, so this is for setting up the spinner.
Here is our spinner. It's a small bearing and a stainless steel rod with an insulator on it.
You want to show them the original one you had?
It doesn't work.
I know, it doesn't work. It's really
I'm not showing it to
beefy.
Them.
Okay, yeah. Okay.
All right, and here's this is the attachment to the top of the toroid. It fits into this bearing very nicely and spins really easily. So we're going to put this on top of the toroid right now with this nut and rod. This should screw right up on top without taking the nut off the toroid. A little stud left. We screw this on. It doesn't have to be super tight.
I hope I can see that. I can't. Okay.
And we're going to set this spinner on top of there. And we're going to give it a little help. And we will fire up the coil one more time. All right. Variac on zero. He's on. The variac all the way up.
Okey-doke.
Let's just show them with the lights off.
Yeah, let's get that with the lights off.
I'll leave that one on. Turn this one off.
Yeah.
We'll do a couple of shots with the lights off, with, mm-hmm. with the spinner and without the spinner. Shots with just the output of the coil?
Sure, yeah, we could do that. Take the spinner off there. And...
make sure we shut the coil down.
Oh, yes, yes.
We can
yes.
edit that right out of there.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's good to show continuity, you know, so that... turn that off. Is it all the way turned up? Okay, yeah.
Okay. Ready?
Yep. Yeah, this,
yeah.
Wanna run that again?
Yeah, here. Can you hit the button?
And I'll
walk over near.
Oh, be careful. All right.
With this. Well, let me, All right, and it's a neon tube. You can tell them it's a neon. It's a green neon tube, which is pretty interesting. You get light fluorescent stuff with it, right?
Yes, and what were you, about 12, 15 feet away?
Pretty close. Was too close.
But you were getting close, yeah. But I think this lights up from about 12.
You can fill that in. We're good, right?
Yep, I think so. This is the special order ammeter, which doesn't normally come with the BTC70. And it shows the current of the operating Tesla coil. It needs to be kept close to the operating components or it won't function properly. And since Tesla coils operate at a high voltage but a low current, there won't be much deflection to see on this current meter. Also, since you'll be standing about 15 feet back away from the sparks, you'll need some kind of magnification if you want to accurately read the meter. Some simple binoculars, maybe 4x magnification, should be plenty. Or zoom in with a camera, like we'll do next here, when we film it working. So this is the rotary spark gap.
And pretty easy to connect this up. We made clips so it's easy, and the clip on each end of the other spark gap. So these two are run in parallel, these two gaps, and you can't run this by itself without these gaps here because we tried many different arrangements, and this suppressor circuit here cannot take the current load from the thing switching on and off. Mm. It needs the other gaps to run consistent, and this, you know, got destroyed when we were testing it. We had to rebuild it. With a cover on it, if you run just the rotary gap, it's going to burn that up, but you won't be able to see it until it's too late because there'll be a wooden cover over this. But as it is, it works really nicely.
Okay, so just be sure you run the rotary spark gap with the linear spark gap. Run them both together. If you run just the rotary gap by itself, you're going to burn out that suppression circuit.
Right.
Also, you don't want to move this too far away. You don't want to move the rotary spark gap too far away from the base of the BTC70, or the lightning strikes can hit the rotary spark gap. And for that reason, we included these short cables, a short attachment cable. So keep it close, keep it snugged in close to the base. If you move it out too far, it could get struck with the output.
Right, because it's protected by the strike ring. You know, if it's going to strike anything, it's going to strike the strike ring.
Yeah.
Okay, here's where our variac is plugged into our rotary gap motor. It's very simple. It just plugs right up into the variac. And you just plug it into the variac, and I'll mark a spot on here where it's 2,000 RPM and where it's at about 1,000 RPM. And you'll have a baseline, and you can play with the speeds as you like.
All right, that sounds good. So that's a basic setup then, just pretty straightforward. Setting up the rotary spark gap to the BTC70 Tesla coil. Okay, so this is the rotary spark gap connected to the BTC70. And we'll turn this on here.
Here's the variac.
The variac controls the speed. You can see this is starting up.
Probably opportune speed is about 2,000 RPM.
So once that spins up, we'll run it. Yeah, let's run it a little bit, and then we can turn the lights off. Maybe get a little bit more of an effect after it runs. Turn the lights off there, and you can do it again. All right, and hopefully that didn't get too blurry, because I know it's set on autofocus. I had to move it around a little bit there, but just get an idea that it works. It's actually got a pretty nice output, I think, once the rotary gap is running.
Yeah, the rotary gap, it makes a little bit of a difference. It's not a heck of a lot, but it is noticeably better.
Yeah, something is different. The thickness of the output seems to be a little more substantial. So what we're going to do here is just show the rotary spark gap running at different speeds and what kind of an effect it has on the Tesla coil. Now, the speeds that you want to use, that's something you'll have to experiment with, but we just want to show you that it'll work at different speeds.
Okay, this is, we have an RPM gauge here. This is pretty slow here. It may not even work for this. This is about 1,000 RPM right there.
At 1,000, yeah, it seemed to work pretty well.
Now if we go slower, we're going to bring it down, we'll show you how it labors when it's slower.
That looks like that's only going at about a couple hundred RPM.
Yeah, it's not quite enough. All right, we'll go back up to 2,000.
Yeah, and a lot of the spark is going to be washed out here because we got all the overhead lights on. Going above 2,000?
Go too fast or else, because it's a lot of weight.
Yeah, it's a lot of strain.
Rip them freaking carbide out of the freaking disc.
Yeah, you gotta be careful with that, wear eye protection.
Centrifugal force going on there.
Yeah, those tungsten rods are fairly heavy. Unless you have a real reason to go above 2,000 RPM, I'd kind of keep it at 2,000.
Yeah. Seemed to do pretty good at about 1,000 also.
Yeah, it did.
Let me wind it down and we'll get it back to 1,000 and see if there's much of a difference.
Yeah, you can't really connect anything to the device
right.
And read it from a distance, because then you got a wire going to wherever you're reading it, which you don't want. You don't want that electrical volt to hit the wire. Yeah, I think that's good. Just show them it runs well at different speeds.